The House of Mystery presents Inside Writing, the radio show where authors discuss their writing process in all genres.
Welcome back into the House of Mystery, and I'm the person responsible, Al Warren. Co-hosting today is John Copenhaver.
Hey, Al. How you doing?
I'm doing good. See, I said it right. I think that's two times in a row. Holy cow, people are going to be thrilled.
Progress.
Yeah, but, you know, as soon as I'm in a rush again, it'll be Copenhagen again.
It's okay. I'm very forgiving.
Danish cigars or whatever. Well, hot day here. How's it back there?
In the east, well, in Richmond, Virginia, it's actually kind of cool, which is very weird for this time of year. But it has been a cold, rainy Memorial Day weekend. So, and now, you know, it's kind of, it'll probably heat up here soon, but.
Beginning of the end, so.
Yes, I'm afraid so.
Don't wait for it. So, so you can't rent a car, I hear.
Yes, so I had to cancel my vacation out west, which was my husband and I were really looking forward to, touring around the Grand Tetons, and we couldn't find a car to rent at a reasonable rate. It's like the cheapest is like $400 a day, which would kind of break the bank. So I'm kind of bummed out anyway.
Well, I'm telling you, just buy a car and return it afterwards. Guess they won't like that.
No.
No. That's a crime.
Probably. It is.
A crime. Now, speaking of crime, we have a mystery writer. And first time on the show. It's going to be a thrill. So, Barbara Wilson, thank you for being here.
Thank you, Alan, for having me on your show.
Now, Barbara, where did writing come from for you? How did it all start?
Well, it started a long time ago when I was eight. I was dyslexic. It took me ages to learn to read. And when I finally did and could read a book, I was enchanted. And from then on, I not only began reading, but I began writing as well because I thought it was so miraculous that I could string words together.
So at what point did you feel like you had confidence enough to let people see what you were writing? Were you able to just put it out right away, or did it take a while?
You know, I had confidence right away, which unfortunately I think was misplaced, since when you're 8 years old, it's not the greatest writing. But my mother was encouraging. She was always encouraging. My dad always said, oh, I hope you get a real job someday. Because I started talking early on about being a writer, I could go to the library, and I knew someone had written all those books. So I thought, why not me? I started putting them together with little pictures and stapling them from the get-go. However, once I was about 20 in college, I suppose, and was reading more great literature, I suddenly had a few qualms. I thought, maybe my mother was wrong. So I think that it took me maybe 10 years to really work hard at writing. I did a lot of things. I did journalism. I did book reviews. I did criticism. And I did many drafts of short stories. And finally, when I was in my later 20s, I thought, now finally, I think I'm really getting the hang of this.
Yeah. Well, you know, I was just had a review on myself saying I wrote like an 8-year-old, so and I'm 59, so you're ahead of me. Criticism.
Oh,
well, you know, yeah. But what do you think of criticism? You know, because nowadays it's not as it used to be when you wrote books and you did things, people, you'd get reviews, but it wasn't the same. Like now there's so much easy access and you can get hundreds of reviews that are just by who knows who, and they say the meanest things, a lot of them. What's your take on the way the world is now and the way we get, you know, I guess scrutinized?
Well, I guess I have mixed feelings. I sometimes look at what people write on Goodreads about my books, and I'm often really amazed at how thoughtful they are, actually. I think a few people do say something mean, but for the most part, actually, people try and engage. You know, the worst that people say is, she's writing about her life and I don't care about her life. that's a little bit hard to take. But otherwise, I'm surprised that people also write some heartfelt feelings. I didn't know about this subject. I'm so glad to know about it. She's one of my favorite writers. You know, that's really nice. And I think because reviews in newspapers have really diminished. It used to be, I can remember, that there would be a handful of newspaper reviews you could hope for, maybe count on a few. But a lot of newspapers don't have book review sections anymore. Right. So I think things have migrated to individuals who post online, who blog, who get their views out in different ways. There's not as much as informed criticism, I would say, but there's a lot more of criticism.
Yeah. Do you like the way the publishing world's gone? You know, the way the self-publishing and Amazon had such a big impact on things?
Well, what are you going to do? It just goes on whether you like it or not. And I suppose, again, it's been democratized a bit. And writers who would have put that manuscript in the desk drawer publish it instead and do get readers. So I like that aspect of it. It's become much more consolidated with the big publishers. But on the other hand, there are always indies popping up, too, who turn out to be successful in their field. So it's I don't know if I could make a definitive statement, let's say. It's always changing.
Yeah. Well, so now you're writing. What do you consider yourself? What kind of writer would you call yourself if someone asked?
Now, at this point, I don't know anymore because when I was younger, I was mostly writing what I would call feminist fiction and genre work, mysteries. And then when I was in my 40s, I started really being interested in nonfiction. So I've written a number of books of nonfiction, of memoir, of travel, and biography even, cultural history, especially in terms of Scandinavian studies. And I published more with university presses. But I also never forgot about some of the mysteries that I'd done and always thought that I would get back to them, which is why I sort of decided to write another mystery and maybe more with my character, Cassandra Reilly, who's a freelance translator.
So when you write a mystery, what's the key or the most important element in the book itself for you?
I think for me as a reader and as a writer, I'm most interested in the detective. That's always been the figure that transfixed me, the person who has the right to ask questions and to move through the crime scene and to burrow into people's lives and wonder where they were on the night of August 3rd. Some of the great eccentric detectives in literature have been fictional characters, whether that was Sherlock Holmes or Miss Marple, and lots of modern detectives as well. So I think that's what I think about, is my detective. Who is she, and why is she asking these questions?
So your detective in your new book, the not the real Jupiter, Cassandra Reilly. Who is Cassandra, and how did you create her?
Cassandra is a freelance translator, and she's an American, but she's an expat. She's based in London, but she's traveled quite a bit. She's a translator mainly of Spanish. And at this point, she's late 60s, early 70s. I think I say she's hovering around 70. When I first created her, she was more in her 40s. And I think I first invented her. I was asked to write a short story for a collection that came out in England when I was living there. And it was called Reader, I Murdered Him. And it was a collection of women's short fiction. And she popped into my mind at that point. She was very playful, lots of jokes about language. I think I was interested because I'm a translator myself. I've translated from the Scandinavian languages, mostly from Norwegian, but also from Danish and Swedish. And I was really interested in sort of the idea of a translator sleuth. I didn't know of any others. And I thought there's some connection between translation and parsing the meaning of words and detecting sleuthing and parsing the meaning of also words from suspects, but also situations and clues.
How much of yourself do you actually put into Cassandra? How much of you comes out?
Well, I'm older now too, so there's that connection we have. I'm much more rooted than she is in that I've been with my partner for quite a while, and I live in the United States in Pacific Northwest, and I have a garden. On the other hand, I have traveled a lot, and I have a strong connection with London, lived there off and on, had a lover, and had friends there, and have spent a lot of time there. So even though I made the decision not to have a life in London or in England or in Europe for that matter, part of me, I suppose, always wonders what would that would have been like. And I think Cassandra is someone who's continued living on and off in north of London. And it gives me a sense of sort of joy and freedom to connect with her in that way.
I have a question, sort of circling back to you mentioned that you're dyslexic, and I'm curious because I teach in my real world. I teach students with learning differences, including dyslexia, and I have some dyslexia myself. And I've known a lot of mystery writers with dyslexia. Do you think there's something about there's a connection between like mystery writing and dyslexia, I guess is what I'm asking. It's really, I'm curious if you ever thought of that.
No, I haven't. And actually, that's actually really interesting. I didn't know that I had dyslexia as a child, and it was a somewhat mild form of it, I suppose. I couldn't seem to read in a straight line. The letters got mixed up. And I still have that problem of transposing letters, like museum. I invariably mix the U and the E. But I think that I figured out some way, which I think a number of dyslexic people do, to kind of overcome that by actually seeing the larger paragraph in some ways and kind of memorizing it a little bit as I read, so that I saw the larger picture rather than the individual sentences. And because it's a learning disability, as well as a little bit of a brain twist and turn, I think you can sort of train yourself. I used to hate word games. I just felt like I'm always so bad at them. Scrabble, crosswords, all of that. I just loathed it. But my wife loves crosswords, and she got me doing crosswords, and I sort of realized once again I could kind of train myself to try and see the words in a line. So what I'm thinking is that there's something about thinking through a mystery with many clues. You have to see the overall picture and get flashes of what might have happened. So you're looking at the big picture, but on the other hand, you've trained yourself to also kind of go more slowly and sort of arrange things in a logical way so it makes sense. So I don't know if that's an answer, but.
No, I mean, I think that's a great thought. I've been thinking about it a lot because I'm also a mystery writer, and I just think that there's something about the way our minds work and how you're describing your dyslexia. It sounds very similar to my own. And then, you know, of course I'm also thinking about how to support kids and realizing that, you know, they often hate writing. I'm like, okay, how can you embrace writing? And I keep on thinking about all these mystery writers that I know. I'm like, it's actually could be a skill for writing that you have.
Yeah. I think now that I'm older, I see it, now that I can name it, I see it as a boon in my life. And I think that it always puzzled me because I thought, how is it possible it took me so long to learn to read? And I was always in the slow reading group, and I felt very embarrassed and shamed about that. How is it that I became a translator? How is it that I became an editor and a writer? How was I able to do that? And it's sort of a mystery, but there's some way, because you're working at it all the time, it starts to make sense. You develop some abilities that you didn't think that you had. And I would think that's true for kids too. I do think there are probably some ways that as a dyslexic, you have to be inventive and you have to be persistent. And those can also be really helpful as a writer.
Absolutely.
We interrupt our programming. This is a national emergency. Important details will follow.
Are you prepared? Legacy Food Storage. The best way to protect your family is by being prepared. Go now to legacyfoodstorage.com. Use coupon code HOM15 now for 15% off. Quick, go!
Welcome aboard Pizza Hut, where our legendary pan and stuffed crust pizzas will fly you to a world of flavors. Taste an all-American pizza sauce, juicy pepperoni, and farm-fresh mozzarella to discover America's mega pepperoni. Or explore the creamy pesto sauce. Chicken and mushroom is in the French creamy chicken mushroom. Fly far above the rest in taste and variety with five new pizzas. And thank you for flying Pizza Hut.
You're listening to the House of Mystery radio show. History, crime, conspiracy, and paranormal mysteries.
Yeah, I wonder if it's just the process of learning, of thinking, working through it. Because I know being on the spectrum, I had a lot of communication problems and with writing and radio. And I do it now, but it still takes a lot of work. Mm-hmm. But I wonder if you work your way, you build yourself up and become at that level where you can perform.
I think we must. Have it in us to think I can make this work for me in some ways. And I think that it also, it gives you an understanding of how your mind works as well as others. And I think that any disability has the potential to increase some compassion and understanding for other struggles that other people have.
How do you think that changes, or how do you think that affects your actual writing, the story, like when, you know, not the real Jupiter, so when someone reads it, are they going to pick up some sort of difference in the way you write because of it?
I wouldn't think so, actually. I mean, I don't know if people think, oh, this plot is rubbish, or this plot is great. Or I like the jokes about language in it. I think I discovered early on that I liked writing in images, that I saw things in images and I saw things in metaphor and simile, and that it's possible that, you know, people could think, oh, that's a feature of her writing, that is very visual in some ways. I don't know. I haven't asked anyone recently.
It's probably better anyway. You'll get all these negative comments.
All right.
I'm still stuck on that because someone actually wrote a review on one of the books that said that, and they complained, actually, their text was complaining about losing their luggage at the airport. And I know it makes no sense to me. And how did it even get posted? And why can it stay up there when it has nothing to do with the reading? I mean, because they had one of my books does not mean the airport lost its luggage. It's really bothering me. So, and it shouldn't, but you know, that's kind of what we deal with, isn't it? So.
Sometimes you can turn those things around and put them in your books, just as a joke.
Yeah.
So you get your revenge somehow.
Yeah.
I've always thought we should have a reading where everyone went and read their worst, like, Goodreads review as a way of reclaiming. You know?
Yeah, it can be devastating sometimes, you know.
I just can't take them seriously. Like, anyone who's just all really just out to be a jerk, it loses all effect. It just doesn't. Yeah. If that someone took me apart in a real sort of sharp critical fashion, now that would hurt. But I'd probably learn something, but it would hurt. Where someone's just being a jerk, I'm like, well, there's jerks out there. I'm frankly no surprise about that.
Right.
No, I think it's all about the person writing too. Like when you put together a story and you put it out there, it's an overall project that you put in, you put yourself into. Someone is going to be mean and say something that's just stupid even. There has to be something that they're going through in order to do that. Like they're letting steam out on you for some reason. And maybe that's just my own thought, but I sort of think that usually it's someone's dealing with their own issues. Now, in your book, what's the most important thing that you want people to get out of it when they read one of your books?
Well, since we're talking about mysteries, I think I would mostly like them to enjoy themselves. And I think that many people have told me that they liked Cassandra. She's a bit quirky, but they do find her generally good-humored. And I think one of the interesting things for me that I'm curious what readers will think of is that Cassandra is older now, and that was my intention. You know, I hadn't published a Cassandra Reilly novel for 20 years because I've been off in Scandinavia and writing a lot about the indigenous Sami and Scandinavia and the Sami and all kinds of interesting things. But I hadn't published a book in quite a while, and so when I was writing this mystery, I thought, I'm just going to let her age. And lots of mystery writers keep their detectives kind of around the same age, you know, 30s, 40s, so that they can do all the physical things that detectives need to do. They can jump out of windows. They can run down the street. They can climb up a ladder and jump off the roof. And you have to think, you know, after all these years, how can Sir Paretsky's detective still do this? Wouldn't she be around 80 by now? But they live in a kind of more nebulous reign, you know, we sort of accept that. But I thought, I want to see what a lesbian who's in her late 60s, 70s, who's financially insecure, she's not retired, things that worked when she was in her 20s and 30s, even 40s, Footloose, lots of girlfriends, traveling around the world, It's more of a challenge when you get to be in your 60s. So I wanted that sense of age to kind of enter. At the same time, our knowledge of aging and the experience of aging is really changing a lot. So there was no reason why I should have an elderly spinster like Miss Marple, who was just sitting around and knitting and was asexual and just sort of said, oh my goodness, well, maybe he killed him. No, I need to think about this a little bit more. I thought, I love that idea of the spinster detective, but why not subvert that a lot? And I've subverted that in other books with some of my plots and my characters, but I thought, I think I'll do that now. I think that makes sense to me to sort of try and change that image of the elderly spinster and make her a woman who is able to move, able to travel, still engaged in the world, and still romantically inclined. That was really fun for me. So I would love readers to carry that away with them, that sense of, oh my goodness, oh my God, here's a woman who's my age or 30 years older. She can still do this.
Do you find it difficult to sequel a character like that? So someone that you wrote about years ago and then you bring them back to remember all of the uniqueness about that person so that you don't make a mistake or forget something or have to change something?
No, I had to look a couple things up from earlier books that told the story, but she already had a kind of discontinuous personality because she's lived in many places and she's done many things, and she's sort of anchored by her friendship with a bassoonist named Nikki Gibbons, who lives in London, who's now retired. But I found it really interesting, instead of confusing, to carry on with her and have her remember things that happened as well as muse on what it's like getting older. She's been with me all this time. She actually feels like a friend of mine. So even though it had been many years since I wrote about her, I felt that it wasn't hard at all to get back into her voice and her state of mind.
That's interesting. You know, where do your characters come from for you? Like, how is it that you develop a character? Is it someone you see in a coffee shop, or is it just out of the blue, or in a dream? Do you hear voices? Like, what goes on for you?
I think characters come in a variety of ways. They're very rarely based on people I know, but they're similar to people I know or have known. And because in my younger years, I was really active in the women in print movement. I had a publishing company. I went to lots of conferences. I traveled a lot and was on panels. I knew bookstore owners. I knew publishers and writers. And I think those are many characters in my books, and I find it easy to conjure them up because there are certain kinds of writers, editors, publishers who I've known all my life. So I know what their concerns are. I know their struggles financially. I know the kinds of secrets they try and keep. So I think that I always have tried to have a somewhat multicultural cast of characters in the mysteries. In this book, Not the Real Jupiter, because Cassandra is a Spanish language translator, there are several Latina women writers who appear, or one is a publisher and a writer, and another two are writers. So, I think about Latina women writers I've known, but I don't try and base it exactly on anyone, just in general.
Now, do you have a favorite, or favorites, influences on your writing? Other writers, other LGBTQ writers? Where do you sort of gain your inspiration?
Well, I think I read really widely, and I have certainly learned from many women writers over the years, as well as male mystery writers. Some of the mystery writers I like best were from the Golden Age. I always liked Nio Marsh, but I love Sarah Caudwell. She's not very well known, and she only wrote a handful of mysteries. But she was a British writer who I thought was very witty and wonderful. I did, I feel like I was very influenced when I was starting out by other women mystery writers, and I would say Amanda Cross was one who had a literary character, Kate Delafield, I think. Actually, I think that was Catherine Forrest who had Kate Delafield.
Yeah, that's right.
But Amanda Cross had another Kate, a Fansler maybe, something like that. At any rate, you know, people like Sarah Paretsky, my work was really different. You know, I never was into the hard-boiled style, but I did read Sarah Paretsky, loved her character. And I was emboldened by many feminist writers of mysteries in the 80s, I think, to want to write more mysteries, to see this as a very viable genre. So in that sense, I don't always think it was the writing that influenced me, but more just their choice of genre that was really inspiring.
Absolutely. Amanda Cross, she writes they're kind of set in an academic setting, right? Am I getting that?
Yes, right.
Yeah, that's what I thought. Mm-hmm.
I think that was the pen name of, it was a pen name of someone who was also a English teacher. What was her name? Oh, it'll probably come to me. But she wrote books on feminist literature. She taught at Columbia. She kind of kept the two separate for quite a while until she finally came out as Amanda Cross.
And you think you write in so many different sort of genres, but, you know, typically from the outside looking in, you have like the more popular, you know, crime genre, and then you have when nonfiction can be seen as more literary. Where do you come from? What's your opinion on that? Do you think there's a real divide, or do you think this is sort of an artificial thing we've constructed, slotting mystery and sort of purely popular, you know, or kind of dismissing it sometimes that way?
Yeah, in my case, I think that I didn't feel fully challenged by mystery writing. And I didn't really want a mystery career, even though I totally love mysteries. I love to watch them, to read them, and I loved writing them. But I didn't feel like I really fit into that genre. I couldn't produce them fast enough, and I wanted to write other things. And I think I wanted to write a memoir. I wanted to write about my childhood. I knew that I wanted to travel and write in my own voice about my travels. And once I had gone up to the north of Scandinavia, I thought there's really so much to say about the north and Scandinavia. And I got pulled into that. And I was not an academic, but I started doing more academic research. So it got further and further away from the genre of mystery writing. But I will say I have utmost respect for mystery authors. And I think that I feel like I had so much support and leeway to write new kinds of characters. When I first started writing the mysteries, I had a different character, Pam Nielsen, who with her twin sister Penny had a printing shop in Seattle. And they took place in the kind of leftist collective era of Seattle in the late 70s and 80s. And I had so much fun with that. But I felt like I was also able to talk about politics and to bring in a wide cast of characters and to both write seriously about death and violence against women, as well as a lighter side. And I don't think you can always do that in traditional literary fiction. I think genre is sometimes where you're allowed to experiment. And at the same time, there's so many serious writers working in genre. So I think that's really important not to ghettoize it or segregate it too much from literature.
Right. Yeah. And I do think that it's true that it can be confining one way or another. It can be confining, and it's sort of refreshing to hear you say that you like the freedom. If you wanted to pivot to something nonfiction, you know, I certainly feel some of those feelings, particularly the producing a book a year, which is out of the question for me.
Yeah, right.
It's tough. It's tough to do that. You got to have the time and the discipline. For me, I'm speaking for me.
Yeah. And the creative mind doesn't always work like that.
That's true.
I do think people struggle to fulfill career requirements because, you know, creativity is something different. And I suppose it all has to do with how do you think of your writing? You know, is it only a career? Is it just something that you're, you know, a path that you have to follow in order to make a living or to satisfy your publishers and readers? Or is writing some kind of journey for you? I mean, not in any mystical sense, but, you know, I do think of creativity as sort of an adventure. And if you can't follow where your mind takes you and into the different projects that you're really passionate about, then what's the point of it? Why would you want to keep writing the same book over and over again?
Yeah, I agree.
Do you find that you, like when you talk about, you know, she's London-based and you talk about Scandinavia and stuff, do you write your location as a character as well?
I have, definitely. You know, London was a very important time in my life, and I've been there many times. And whenever I go there, I sort of feel like I slip back into that life of North London, Islington, Stoke Newington, Caledonian Road. And so that's very much a part of the books. But I've also spent a lot of time in Spain and lived in Barcelona. And in Gaudí Afternoon, that book was definitely, Barcelona was a big character in that. And the same in Venice. And to write my book about Cassandra that was in Romania and Hungary, I went there and went to Romania shortly after became non-Soviet and was kind of enchanted by that whole world too. So that was a big part of, I think place has always been a huge part of my writing, but it's especially huge in terms of the Cassandra books. It's a little bit different with a new one, which is set in Oregon. It starts in Montevideo, Uruguay, but it sort of relocates to the Bay Area and then to the coast of Oregon. And again, that became almost a character in the book.
Hmm. What would you give for advice for a person that's a brand new writer right now?
Oh, well, you know, there's probably nothing that they don't know. There's so many writing books available and there's so much advice. But again, you have to find your own way through all of this. So I think that, first of all, you have to learn to sit in one place. People don't think about that when they think about writers, that it is a little bit solitary and you do have to train yourself to sit somewhere usually for 3 or 4 hours every day if you can, if you're going to produce books anyway. I also think that it's important to find a group of people that you can share your writing with. I think that makes all the difference because otherwise you're going to probably feel way too lonely. And there are all kinds of groups available, you know, through the library, through different organizations online. So I'd seek out like-minded people. Those are probably the two most important things.
Hmm. So now, do you have a website or do you have a place that you'd like people to come and find out more about you?
I have two websites. One is my last name, BarbaraShuholm.com. And that has more about the translations and nonfiction books that I've done. And then I have a newish site called BarbaraWilsonMysteries.com. And that's all about my mysteries.
So what's next?
I'm working on another Cassandra book that's set in Belgium and London and having lots of fun with that. And I have a big book coming out from the University of Minnesota Press next year that is on museums and the collection of Sami objects over 400 years and what happened to them, how they ended up in museums. So I'm kind of excited about both of those projects.
I was going to say, yeah, you do lots of traveling, but I guess with COVID, that's kind of cut down, isn't it?
Yeah, I have nowhere that I've been. My wife and I are planning to drive to Montana this summer and are really looking forward to that. A little bit nervous. We're going to Glacier National Park.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Yeah. Yeah, she's a wildlife biologist for the Forest Service. So she's a fun person to travel with when we're going outdoors.
Yeah. Did you find, so when you're writing, do you find that things like COVID and, Trump, all the weird stuff in the last years, does that have an influence? Do you think it seeps into your writing?
Yeah, but it's hard to know how to get that in. I haven't dealt with the fact that COVID would have severely curtailed Cassandra's travels. When I started writing my book, Not the Real Jupiter, COVID hadn't happened, but Trump was very much in power. And I have Cassandra kind of returning to the States after some time away and driving through the Oregon landscape and seeing some signs. But I didn't want to go too far down that road. Because I didn't know how to. I think for a lot of writers, it's just been almost too much to live through, much less to process and reproduce in our writing. And I felt that way about Trump. You know, it was like this gigantic dark cloud in the sky that blotted out the sun for 4 years. So I felt hugely affected by it, but it could not find its way into my writing very easily. And I'm not sure how to deal with COVID either in terms of Cassandra. I mean, she would have been stuck in London, I'm presuming. It would be much too complicated to have her stuck someplace else in the world, I suppose. But yeah, it's going to change everything about travel.
Well, and not only that, even the years with Trump and just all the weirdness that was going on and the stress, Do you think that makes you, even without including that, does that make you write a little darker?
In some ways, possibly. It's hard to be always optimistic when you know what people are capable of and, what the United States history is and the constant threat now of, return to authoritarianism. I'm kind of an optimistic, cheerful person, and I certainly have been on the left for a long time. And so I believe in change, and I have seen change throughout my long life. But I don't know where things are going. I have invested quite a lot of energy in writing about the indigenous people of the far north, and I think that's partly because I do see so much change and progress in that area, and I've been an ally in some ways. And I think part of the reason I'm an ally is that I do come from a racist, though a very interesting multicultural country. I find it actually quite difficult in my writing to know how to write about the United States directly. I can only seem to write about it slant somehow. And yeah, I think that's often been true.
Well, there's so many elements,
Yeah.
And how can you define it? It's hard. Do you worry about the political correctness or about writing a certain subject that you get cast in a certain light?
No, not anymore. I mean, one of the pleasures of getting older is who cares? But I certainly got a lot of criticism when I was younger because of some of the things that I wrote about. And um, I You know, again, I'm not really an editorialist. So what I liked about writing mysteries in the 1980s, and one of them sort of took on the subject of lesbian sadomasochism, and I had this sort of even-handed approach in a way, with, you know, characters who espoused one thing, characters who did another, hypocrisy. It was really great fun to try and bring all those voices into concert. And I think a number of readers loved that because it was such a confusing issue. And people didn't know what they thought about a lot of these aspects. Was it derogatory towards women? Was it positive for women? So there were lots of fighting about it. And I captured some of that in the book. So, of course, I got some flack for even attempting this. And people always wanted to know what I personally thought. But maybe because I'm kind of a calm person or a Libra, I'm not sure, it was sort of like, well, I don't know. I hear what they're saying, but I don't do that myself. But that's interesting. I didn't want to be wishy-washy. I wanted to engage, but I wanted to allow many voices to be heard. And so I'm not afraid of being politically incorrect. And certainly I'm not afraid of it now. It matters very little to me.
Well, they'll be attacking you on Twitter.
Yes, but I hardly ever look at Twitter, so I didn't know.
Yeah, kind of. I guess that is true. As you get older, those things mean so much less, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a good thing about getting older. I think getting older is actually completely fascinating.
Well, it is, but I find it very strange because I don't feel in the mind older, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
You know, the body just doesn't.
Yeah, doesn't, both doesn't, things are true.
You know.
And I think that's why it's so fascinating, is just you're aware that things are starting to crumble a bit. Or maybe a lot, I don't know. But the mind ranges freely all over, you know, from your childhood through your middle years. I feel it's a very reflective time, but it's also fun and active somehow, too. It's very different from being middle-aged.
Mm. Well, there we go. You hear it all. Well, it's certainly an interesting conversation, and we appreciate you being here. The book we're featuring is not The Real Jupiter. It's a Cassandra Reilly mystery, and our guest has been the author, Barbara Wilson. Thank you for being here.
Thank you, Alan. Thank you, John.
Thank you, Barbara.
To find out more about our show, guests, or to listen to past shows from our archive, please go to www.houseofmysteryradio.com.
The mission has been completed.
The end!
By George, he's got it! It is the end!
I'll tell you.
If you're lying to me, I'll be back.
This has been a production of Something Weird Media.